Hello and welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Melissa Helen, working as assistant professor in Nizam College, Usmania University. Today, we are going to look into the module on African and Caribbean literature. And we are going to take a look at a few select poems of Kofi Awanur, the poet from Ghana. Before we go into the details of the poet and the poems, I would just like to highlight the tragic circumstances of Kofi Awanur's death. In his own words, Kofi Awanur wrote in his poem, Revolution, "Why must we be afraid of cannon and rains? For death by any means is death." These are the words of the courageous poet, novelist, academic, diplomat, statesman, and an intellectual visionary, Kofi Awanur, the poet from Ghana, who at the age of 78 was killed along with several others in a terrorist attack at Westgate Mall in Nairobi, Kenya in 2013. Awanur was actually attending a four-day Story Moja Hay festival, and he had a poetry performance in the afternoon session of that ill-fated day. When news of the blast reached the conference organizers, and his absence only confirmed their suspicion. His body was identified and later sent to Ghana for cremation and a state funeral. In a letter from Nairobi, Kofi seemed to be having a kind of a sixth sense about his own death. He said, "I have something to say, and I will say it before death comes. And if I don't say it, let no one say it for me. I will be the one who will say it," said Kofi Awanur. Some of the glowing tributes paid to him in recognition of his substantial contribution to African literature, politics and culture bear testimony to his lifetime achievement and the respect he earned worldwide for his commitment towards art and literature. His involvement was a passionate involvement in contemporary politics, and the literary works that he has created reflect a lifetime engagement with his two prime passions, engagement with literature and politics. His death left great anger in Nobel laureate Professor Wole Soyinka, who simply said, "Rage, rage and rage is all I feel at the death of Kofi Awanur." According to Maxim Ozuto, poet and essayist, Awanur can never be written about in the past tense. He believes that Awanur is an ever-present ancestor, and he says that this earth, my brother, is an existential tour de force. And in that book, he says, not even death can kill Kofi Awanur, let alone the moronic mullahs of terror. To go into the biographical details of Kofi Awanur, actually his name was George Awanur Williams, which he later changed to Henoga Kofi because he wanted to remove the anglicized tag. Born in 1935 on March 13th in Weta of Ghana, Kofi Awanur was educated at Achimoto School. Awanur actually grew up on the lap of his grandmother, who was actually a traditional singer of dirges or songs of lament in the Yu culture. And in this Yu culture, people burst into song during both sad and joyous occasions. And you can see a lot of influence of this Yu native culture and the contemporary and the religious symbolism. And you find all this depicted in Awanur's poetry. To go into his education, Awanur studied literature at the University of London. And during his stay in England, he wrote several radio plays for the British Broadcasting Corporation. He later earned an MA and went on to do his PhD in comparative literature in 1973 at Stony Brook. While writing about Ghana's cultural erosion and heritage, he resorted to the traditional lamentation mode for which his poetry gained recognition far and wide. After getting his PhD, he went to the University of Ghana, where he taught African literature. He wrote his first book, Poetry Rediscovery, during his teaching stint at the University of Ghana. Published in 1964, the book, like most of his works, is based on African oral poetry. In 1975, he returned to Ghana as the head of the English department. Within a few months, he was arrested for helping a soldier who apparently was accused of plotting to overthrow the military government. And then, based on this, Avanur was imprisoned without trial, but fortunately was released later. One of Avanur's celebrated collections of the poems, from which we are going to take up the poem Revolution, is titled under The House by the Sea. All the poems written in this anthology are born out of his experiences in the jail. The prison experiences sharpened his political sensibilities further, and Avanur veered into politics, which influenced him to write mostly a number of non-fictional works also. For example, some of them are titled Ghana, A Political History from Pre-European to Modern Times. And he also wrote The African Predicament, a collection of essays. Politically, he served as Ghana's permanent representative to the United Nations for a term of 4 years from 1990 to 94, where he headed the Committee Against Apartheid. He was also a former chairman of the Council of State. Now, to go into the artistic and creative endeavor of Avanur. For most African writers, writing is a part of deep commitment to society. And Avanur also believed that a writer is primarily a member of his own society. And there is no time when he cannot be committed to ending the sufferings of his own people. For where does art and culture stop and the business of life and survival begin, says Avanur. Similarly, he felt strongly that a literary scholar or poet should be involved in politics. Because African politics is constructed from a socio-cultural base. In Tradition and Continuity in African Literature, Kofi defines the role of an artist who is both a technician and a visionary. For him, there is no division between the two roles. His technical competence enables him to select and utilize material. Material includes words, wood, raffia, or whatever, which in themselves carry a spirituality or an innate essence. It is from here that the transformation into the visionary realm is primarily fed. According to Kofi, forms and motives already exist in an assimilated time and world construct. The poet only serves as an instrument of transforming these into an artistic whole based on his own imaginative and cognitive world. In other words, poetry for Kofi Avanur is the magic of the word, the magical and the mysterious relationship, defining only the very simple and the mundane, which have time beyond time and place their anchorage in words. In the clash between traditional and Western, Avanur chose the middle ground, as he saw a possibility somewhere between those two positions. In Breast of the Earth, Avanur says, those who call for a total Europeanization of Africa are actually calling for cultural suicide, and those who are asking for a pure and pristine journey into the past are dreamers who need to wake up. During his stint at the African Institute of African Studies, Avanur came into contact with Kwame Nkrumah of Ghana legend, who specialized in oral poetry, and he has been greatly influenced by Nkrumah. Nkrumah also insisted that poetry and Africanist ideologies stimulate the birth of a specifically African literature, which explores African themes and the depth of African soul. And this will become an integral portion of a general world literature. And they did not want African literature to be an appendage of world literature, but African literature should become an integral portion of world literatures. His list of works, to mention a few, include a number of poetical collections: Rediscovery and Other Poems, Night of My Blood, Ride Me My Memory. Some of his novels are This Earth, My Brother, Comes the Voyager at Last. He has also written plays titled The Ancestral Power and The Lament. Now, what are the things that dominate Kofi's writings? If you look into the topics and the themes, for Kofi, there were a number of issues. Of course, the primary concern was Africa, the slave trade, colonialism, the personality of the educated African, and also the corruption in African politics. Orality is another vital aspect of Kofi's works, and his works validate the fact that African oral forms have the grace and power of rhetoric and the poetic authority. Hope and the search for a new tomorrow in post-colonial Africa, stuck with its bitter colonial past, is yet another concern of Kofi, which you find in the fourth poem. Kofi was also looking out for a synthesis of Western values and technology with a basically humanistic African culture. Thematically, Kofi called on the Africans to uphold African traditional culture as the realm from which one has to rediscover the African personality, the African sense of being and knowledge. Of course, some of his poems also deal with the painful experience of exile and longing. Now, to look at a few poems selected for your study here. The first poem is titled The Revolution, from the collection House by the Sea. This was written during the poet's imprisonment in Asher Fort Prison, Accra, in 1976. Now, in this poem, the poet chides and reprimands his people for their complacent attitudes towards the African leaders, unfortunately, who are no better than the colonialists. So he says, "We must use our brains." And the poet Avano tries to awaken his people who are actually blind to the realities. In the second poem, Harlem on a Winter Night, from the collection Ride Me Memory, this is reminiscent of his experience during his period of exile, which is spent mostly in the United States. Harlem is a street and a big cultural capital of the African Americans who congregated in the America. Avanur employs haunting imagery to convey the sadness and misery of Harlem in the 70s. Weaver Burr, from the collection of In Discovery and Other Poems, is one of his well-known poems because it was frequently anthologized. Like Chinua Achebe's Things Fall Apart, this poem tells about the story of the Western colonial subjugation of Africa and its people. The poet Avanur calls upon Africans to decolonize their minds and to restore their indigenous traditions, which were obliterated by the colonial master. The final and the fourth poem that we will quickly take a look into is titled Across a New Dawn. And as the title suggests, it's a poem full of hope for a new beginning. And this is a valuable aspect of all Kofi's writings. Kofi Avanur returned in 1975 to teach at the University of Ghana after an 8-year exile, which was mostly spent in the US. But then shortly afterwards, as already mentioned, he was arrested on the charge of aiding someone accused of involvement in an attempt to overthrow the military government, the Ashipong regime. A number of human rights organizations based in the US protested this arrest in strongest terms and interceded on his behalf. Even the Amnesty International, PEN International, and they formed a committee to free Kofi. And from his prison experiences, a fine volume of poems titled The House by the Sea emerged. Now, this volume is divided into two parts. The first part is called the before the journey. And the second section, or the second part, is titled Homecoming Poems from Prison. Avanur became more and more involved with the Ghanaian politics and government after his release from the prison in 1976. And according to his twin brother Kofi Anidhoho, who himself is again a writer and academic, Kofi Avanur was passionate about what he called the distresses of his country and the chicanery of politics and the men who didn't indulge in them. Most of the prison poems speak about the torture and the morbid descriptions that are characteristic of prison life. And he wrote all these poems hurriedly on toilet paper and smuggled them out discreetly. For Avanur, the jail is a citadel of premeditated madness. And to get the best sleep, he says one must visit a jail. And the poet notes sarcastically that time in a jail is not measured by the hourglass, but by the rivulets of blood. When he returned to Ghana from US, he found Ghana under the dictatorial rule. Most African states were under authoritarian rule. Coups, corruption, nepotism in post-independence era as African leaders turned despotic, and by the 80s there was widespread discontent and disillusionment in most of the newly formed African states. And to make matters worse, African leaders turned to the West for more and more aid. And this actually pushed Africa into further dependence on the West, and Africa became a mere satellite. So, in the first few lines of the poem Revolution, it talks about the poet's disenchantment at the political repression in his country. And Avanur says, "It is better to die than to lie awake and see the degradation of his country." In Revolution, Avanur finds it a better option to die rather than to live under oppression and the mortal fear of tyranny imposed by the neo-colonial African leaders who were ruling Africa. Once his people awakened to the present realities, Avanur hoped that his country would experience true economic prosperity, because psychological emancipation alone would lead to economic freedom. So, in his poem, he longs for such a day when Ghana and Africa would have a blossoming of fruit trees, overabundance of rice, the overweight of the plantain, the eternal season of fish. The poem Revolution also talks about how he hopes that the basic infrastructure like goods, roads, schools, hospitals, and a space and dignity where the old and the infirm would be respected would be found in the new Africa. Avanur envisions that his society will be inclusive and also more tolerant, without sectarian beliefs and violence, which is actually the true meaning of democracy. While his first poem, Revolution, talked about the dismal conditions of Africa and Ghana in particular, the second poem, Harlem, talks about the beautiful America as perceived by the outside world, which is actually an ugly wart on the otherwise flawless, unblemished skin. Harlem, the political and cultural capital of Black America, also reminds us of the dark chapter in American history. American history, full of racial segregation and repression of Blacks for centuries. Harlem is actually a neighborhood in New York, which is a major hub of African American community. And this is a symbol of oppression of the marginalized and the dispossessed, where there is rampant poverty, crime, and violence. Though Harlem is the epicenter of Harlem Renaissance, which brought forth a creative explosion in music, literature, and art from 1910 and up to the 1930s, still, Harlem has a lot of poverty and it lacked basic infrastructure, and crime is at its peak in Harlem Street. So Avinor, through a series of black, dismal and powerful imagery, tries to recreate this experience that all the African Americans went through in Harlem Street. So he refers to blacks who are huddled together like a group of animals, and the only sound in the dull winter night is the police siren wailing. This actually suggests non-stop violence and an alarming crime rate. The poet refers to creaking elevators, jammed doors, which all suggest the lack of basic necessities and decent infrastructure. Overall, the poem is a glaring defeat of America, which is supposedly gaining a superior position in the global hegemony, and Harlem Street and the poem Harlem now talks about how America, which is considered so beautiful and bright on a sunny morning, whereas Harlem is only a sad song and can only be equated with a dark winter evening. We saw that the first poem, Revolution, was talking about his own Ghana politics and the corruption. Harlem referred to the discrimination and the bitter conditions in America. The third poem, We Were Bird, refers to colonization. As already pointed out, this poem talks about the subjugation of the indigenous culture, beliefs and practices, and the domination of the colonized by the colonizer. Using the metaphor of the weaver bird, which came from far west, the poet refers to weaver bird and uses it as a metaphor for the colonizers who came from far places and built a nest and later began to own the nest, preaching salvation to us that own the house, he says. So just like the various colonialists who came as guests to the various regions in Africa, the colonizer invaded and colonized the psyche of the natives. They othered Africans and looked at them as uncivilized and savage people, and believed that they alone, that is the West alone, can offer them salvation and bring civilization. This theme is a stereotypical theme which can also be found in Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness. Avinor is very angry at the colonizer, and he uses the word excrement to show his profound hate and dislike of the beliefs and the practices of the West, which have tried to wipe away the indigenous way of life. And he hopes that Africa, unfortunately, will realize the tragic error or the blunder, just like the weaver bird returned in the guise of the owner. The fourth poem, Across a New Dawn, is a poem full of hope, where the poet longs and is looking for a time when a new dawn and a new beginning will arise. He believes that all hope is not lost for Africa and Africans who have actually been looted and exploited in every sense of the term. So Avinor uses terms like ancestral wealth, pillaged, purloined and pawned. He is angry with the Africans who lived the life of a lord and drove coming generations to despair and ruin. Despite the fact that the worm eats, the poet refers to a grain growing. This is a poem of hope, because once again the poet resists death like he resists death in the prison verses. So here he says that there is much to be done, a lot of unfinished tasks and duties and chores. Though there's a reference to symbols of death and funeral, yet the poet looks forward to rebirth and regeneration despite the years of violent histories and geographies in his country. Despite the dismal situation, Avanur hopes that there will be a resurrection with laughter and dance, and they would have a festival of meat where young lambs and the red porridge and new corn would be served. Avanur has always strived very hard to write about the ultimate victory over sorrowful circumstances, especially in the death and resurrection of hope through various creative transformations. And this poem is a poem of Avanur's promise of hope. We hope you've really learned a lot of things about Kofi Avanur, the Ghana poet. He has written poems forming out of the Yu culture, and his poems talk about themes right from colonialism, hope, and the dictatorial regime against which he fought. And Kofi Avanur's own terrible, tragic death is a mark of his fight for reformation in both politics and literature. For more, you can refer to the e-text and also go through the suggested reading. Thank you.